Now we are moving on to the cognitive process as explained in Ayurvedic classics, especially Charaka Samhita. So the central characteristic of being conscious, as we have already discussed, it is a knowledge process. So what will be the differentiating feature of an organism, also of a living organism from non-living organism, will be production of knowledge. It can be a simple receival of stimulus, or it can be a complex interpreted knowledge. Anyway, that knowledge processing is the basic event which differentiates a living organism from, it is called cognition. So all living organism basically differs from a non-living by means of acquiring mechanism for sensing and responding. Sensing and responding is the basic event, as we have already explained in the case of a knowledge production. But there is an interpreter in between. Sensing, responding are the we can call directly observable phenomenon in the processing of knowledge, but there is an internal part of the sensing and responding that is called the mental process that we have already explained, that is going to explain in detail. Presence of a system which receives, analyzes and responds to the different stimuli makes living being distinct from non-living. That system is called, altogether it is called the manas or psyche, as we have already explained. And you can represent the system in this way. There is here it is the external world. Here it is the external world, and this black box is the physical body, which is the framework for containing the mechanism. And here it is a consciousness, and as an extension to this consciousness, there is a mind is there, and five organs are there, and sense organs, the external instruments are there, and their input will be coming to the soul. So this is the representative, figurative representation of the system. So body is there, shariram is there, sharira, indriya, sattva, atma, samyogam is called the system. Going to the details of the process, as we have already mentioned, receival of the stimulus and to respond to the stimulus is the only visible process. So you see receiving some stimulus are going inside, and you see some response coming outside. So these are the visible portion of a being. You can see the behavior are visible here. According to receiving a stimulus, there will be a response. So this response can be behavior. So this part is the visible portion of a cognitive process. As we have already seen, all the stimuli are not received as such. There is a mechanism for interpretation. So the whole process happens inside. It's not visible outside, but the behavior is visible outside. So even though 100% receive the same stimulus, the responses can be in 100 ways, 100 different ways. Why this different does happen is according to the process inside. So there is a long process inside. So the stimulus received is sensed by the faculty, and there will be an image on mind, and there will be an evaluation on the merits and demerits. That is described in Charaka Samhita. Indriyena indriyartho hi samanaskena grihyate. Samanaskena indriyena indriyartho hi grihyate. The sense is received by the faculty in the presence of mind. And kalpyate manasatu urdham. The mind evaluates. Kalpyate manasatu urdham gunato doshato athava. There will be analysis. So there should be an organ for analysis. Now, for the time being, you can call it as manas. So there will be an evaluation on merits and demerits. But there is another faculty called ahankaram. So the merits and demerits will be evaluated on the basis of how does it affect me. Every time there is a notion of ahankaram in this evaluation. Because with reference to me is the evaluation happening. So from here onwards, invariably there is a presence of ahankaram. And determinative knowledge, that is called buddhi or intellect, the decision maker. Okay, after the evaluation, there will be a determination. That determination or decision also will be based on the consequences on me. Ines is, ahankaram is there. So all these process, invariably, unknowingly, there will be the presence of ahankaram. Here it is manas itself, sankalpam, sankalpa vritti, or kalpyade, kalpana is evaluation. So that is carried out by manas. And the final decision, determination, or determinative process is carried out by the word which is called buddhi. And behind all these process, there will be definitely, behind all these process, the total process, there will be another factor called ahankaram. That is not directly mentioned here, but it is there. And according to the knowledge, the final knowledge, there will be a decision. Kalpyade manasadu urtham gunado doshado athava. On the basis of that kalpana, there will be decision of the response. Vyavasthiti taya vaktum kartum va buddhipurvakam. In between, there will be a determinative knowledge. Jayate vishaye tasmin ya buddhir nischayatmika. That nischayatmika buddhi is the capacity of intellect. Again, the decision also, decision on the response also will be carried out by buddhi, because buddhi is the deciding factor. So analyzing factor will be there. You can call it as manas. Behind all this process, there will be another factor called ahankaram, because the whole internal process, the referential point will be, how does it affect me? So that notion is there every time. So ahankara is invariably present here. And finally, there will be a decision on the response. Vyavasthiti taya vaktum kartum va buddhi purvagam. On the basis of the buddhi or determinative knowledge, another thing is vyavasaya, means to decide. So that also comes under buddhi. So decision will be there on the way in which the situation should be responded. So this is deciding the response. Finally, it will be, the response will be of two types. One will be the psychological response. For example, if you decide that you develop some fear, that is a response also. That is psychological. But while affecting the fear on your mind, changes will be there on your body. So you will be sweating, the heart rate will increase, the respiratory rate will increase, you want to flight from the situation, or some responses will be there. So the response will be either psychological, if in the case it is fear, but the another part of the response will be physiological. So there is a bridge in between psychology and physiology here. So deciding the response. And if you want to run away from the situation, your padam should be active. So the response is executed by your pada indriyam, karma indriyam, padam. Okay. So in that way, after receiving the stimulus, there will be the chain of process inside. And the response will be, as we have already told, that all the stimuli are not responded uniformly by different persons. And the difference in the response comes here. How it is evaluated, how it is finally determined, and how it is, the response is finally decided, and how to execute the response, whether it should be delayed, whether it should be reversed, or whether it is modified. All such things will be undertaken by this complex phenomena inside, and the response only will be visible outside. So a response of person A will be different from response of person B, because this process is, in this process, all the things are according to me. Ahankaram is there. Ahankaram means it's personal. My ahankaram will be different from another ahankaram, another person's ahankaram. So it is, all things are personalized in the presence of ahankaram. So the response also will be personalized. So this is the process. And this process, you can call it as a primary process inside. And the visible portions are here only. And if this process is absent totally, such a response, you can call it as a reflex. Stimulus is received and response is there. All the reflex will be uniform to Reflex, if it is a reflex, it will be uniform because there is no internal process. So that is the difference between a reflex and a cognitive process. In a reflex, stimulus will be received and uniformly, invariably, each and every person will be responding in the same way because there is no internal manipulation. There is no internal interpretation. This process, this box will be closed. There is no function here. So such a response is called a reflex. So in that way, this process explains why the response of an event in different persons differ in character. Okay, this is a very important thing. This can be called as the cognitive process or the base of cognitive psychology in Ayurveda. So as I already explained here in this picture, while explaining this process, there came three terms. One is manas. Manas is for feeling something, or you can call it here feeling something, and manas is for analyzing something also. So both those functions are attributed to manas. And another factor I explained is buddhi or intellect, which is determinative or decisive. So such a factor is called buddhi. And behind all these things, there is another factor called ahankaram. Ahankaram is the I-ness. So these three terms are very important in a process of psychology. So that is tripartite unit. Intellect has the power of discrimination, which judges the distinctiveness of a different stimulus. And ego has possessiveness, which determines the role of I in the whole process. So interpretation based on ego. And mind has a power of analysis, which finally evaluates the merits and demerits and stimulus based on above. Evaluation is from the part of manas, but the decision is from the part of buddhi. Both these things will be based on ahankara. This is the relationship between these three factors. And you can represent the whole things which I have explained in this way. In the initial part, we explain the whole process in three terms, that is Shariram, Atma and Sattva. Tridandatmaka Purusha. So Sattvam Atma Shariram cha. So this Sattvam, you can call Sattvam as Manas, and the whole one third fraction in different colors represents the Manas. And I have already explained that you can call it as an internal apparatus, internal instrument. That instrument itself has four parts in it, four functional fragments in it. It's not structural fragments. You can say four functional fragments. In those fragments, buddhi, manas and ahankaram, I have already explained. That is, how does it affect me is called ahankaram. Feeling and analysis comes to buddhi, manas and final decision or intellectual is it is good. It is decided that that input is good. Good means it is finally decided. It's good. Here it is the analysis and feeling. Here it is decision. And finally, all these processes, through all these processes, you define the characteristic of this event or stimulus. And you put it in your chittam for further reference. Because the event will be repeated at any time in the future. In all such situations, you will be having a memory of the previous event. So for the reference in the future, you have to deposit or you have to preserve the inputs from all these domains to another domain called, such a domain is called Chittam, which is responsible for Smriti. Usually we divide this internal apparatus into three, that is called Andhakarana Tridayam. Andhakarana, Trivitha Andhakaranam, but in Yoga Darsanam there is another component called Chittam. Usually Buddhi, Manas and Ahankaram are the three compartments of Manas, but including the concept of Chitta, Yoga Darsanam, I have taken that concept also in this context. So there is Chittam, so let me save it for further reference, and all those information will be saved in your Chittam for further reference. So these four fractions together you can call it as Manas, And manas is specifically vannamangam. It's not a structural division, but a functional division. The same manas can be in the role of buddhi when it decides something. The same manas can be in the role of manas itself when it feels something. The same manas can be in the role of ahankaram when you think of yourself. And the same manas can be in the role of chittam when you preserve the information for further reference. So altogether, this can be called manas or sattvam. And the same sattvam, functionally, it can take four roles, as in the case of myself. Myself is at the same time I am a father. Simultaneously, I am a son also. I can have two roles at different perspective. For my father, I am a son, and for my son, I am a father. So what is my role? My role can be, at a time it can be a role of father, at another time it can be the role of son. In the same way, or there is only one entity which can have different roles at different points of reference. So there can be four roles. Soul is the whole thing which is in the background, and body is the physical framework, or I need your help. I means here it is soul. So here it starts. It's me, nothing more than that. It's the presence of me which decides everything. I cannot do anything, but I should be there. That is the declaration of soul. So this is the mechanism or dynamics of the internal apparatus in Ayurvedic perspective or in the perspective of our darshanas, especially Sankhya and Yoga. So we are moving on to some other aspects of the cognitive process. What will be the fate of a stimulus received by the process? Any stimuli, if received, creates an impression in terms of two basic affects, that is pleasure and pain. So sukham and dukkham, you can call it as sukham and dukkham. Sukham and dukkham are the basic affects. Almost always we use a dichotomic method in explaining such terms, dharmam, adharmam, sukham, dukkham, iccha, dvesham and all. But there can be a situation where the actual character of stimulus is obscure. It results in confusion. There can be a third option. So it becomes a triplet. Pleasure and pain is there basically, but there can be another situation in which an organism is reaching in a confusion to decide whether the basic characteristic of the input or the stimulus is indefinite. So such a situation creates a confusion. So these three principles, pleasure, pain and confusion, can turn into desire, aversion and inertia respectively. Desire and aversion is iccha dvesham. So iccha dvesham sukham dukkham, it is the basic thing. These are the basic things happening, but there can be a third variable, that is a difficulty in deciding the real characteristic of the event, of the stimulus can be there. There can be a confusion, and this confusion leads a person to inertia or inhibition. So the dichotomy is developed into the triplet, or three terms, desire, aversion and inertia. Here comes the concept of three attributes or triguna. That is, as explained, there are pleasure, pain and confusion. In other words, they can be happiness, arrogance and depression. These are identical. Pleasure is identical to happiness, pain with arrogance and confusion with depression. So man is capable of having only three types. There can be any number of combinations, but basically these are the three types of affects. In Sanskrit, when translated to Sanskrit, they are sukham or preeti, that is the pleasure principle or happiness principle. Dukkham or apreeti or dvesham is a aversion principle. Moham or Vishada is the inhibition or a confusion principle. The same object can produce these three affects in one person at different times or different persons at the same time. This is a very basic law regarding that. I will explain it with the help of a picture. Here, there is a stimulus. This is the flower. Can call it as a rose flower. So this is A, B, and C. Three persons are there. Three persons respond to the thing, or they feel the thing in three different ways. One is happy, the other one is anger, you can call it as arrogance or furious. The third one is confused. He could not identify which actually is the meaning of that event or stimulus. So there can be basically three events. It can be three persons at a time, or can be a person at three different points of time. So this is not a permanent affair. So the same stimulus in the morning, the person becomes happy. In the evening, due to some other confounding factors. So these are called why this there are three different emotions or three different affects for the same person at different points of time will be affected by, or the emotions affected by confounders, as this is a term richly used in research. Confounders means some other factors which can affect the original factor. So there can be confounders, confounding factors, which when affected on the emotion can change the emotion. So in the morning, while he was in a ha some factors which are supporting to the happiness, but while in the evening he may be in another mood. In that mood, in that confounding factor, the same vision, same object can precipitate another emotion, or it can repeat like this also. So that is why the same object again can produce these three affects in one person at different times, or in different persons at the same time. So what is there in a flower? The person may confused of a flower, may hate a flower or like it at various instances of knowing the flower. Similarly, when A likes the flower, B may hate it, and C. Three persons can respond in three ways also. Why? Proper knowledge of an object generates pleasure. This is pleasure. Happiness or sukham is a, or preeti is a byproduct of proper knowledge. Paining by an object causes hatred or aversion, and ignorance of an object causes depression and confusion. This is very important. Since all objects can generate pleasure, hatred, and confusion in us at various times, or in various persons simultaneously, we may conclude that all objects contain the stimulating factors for pleasure, pain, and confusion. Any object can produce three types of affects. Means this object is capable of producing three affects. That means it contains stimulating factors of pleasure, pain, and confusion. This varies according to this factor. That is, we too have, human beings too have, as our minds have the ability to react the objects with the pleasure, pain, and confusion, our minds should have the receptors for these three effects. So this is a transmitter receptor relation. There is a transmitter receptor relationship between the object and a person or a mind. So object will be transmitting something, or object can transmit three stimulus, three types of stimulus. That is this sattvam, rajas, and tamas. On the other side, the person can receive, the person or person's mind has three types of receptors that can receive any one of these. So three receptors are there, through transmitters are there. So receptor and transmitter should be the same nature so that the transmitted signal can be received. It is true with the radio transmitters and receivers. Same as the wavelength or the frequency in which it is transmitted will be received if the radio is tuned to that frequency. So this radio will be having three frequencies, transmitter will be having the same three frequencies transmitted. So this will be received there. In the case of receptors of sense objects too, the same criterion is valid. If a person becomes arrogant in perceiving an object, the object should contain an arrogating factor. A person should also possess some arrogance factor. By the rules of similars, Amanya Vishesham, arrogance factor of the object could increase the arrogance factor of the perceiver and generate arrogance in him. In the same way, the object is having a transmitter having happiness, transmitting happiness. The person will be having a receiver of this happiness. So when this comes here, it will be added to his happiness. A happiness will be precipitated. So the likewise the third factor also. So there are two factors. One is the object and the other is the mind. Whatever capacities are there in the object, three factors transmitted will be received here, because here it is receptors, corresponding receptors are there. So in that way, the object and the mind are composed of similar principles. That is why usually we explain manas as trigunatmakam, but if manas is trigunatmakam, objects received also will be trigunatmakam. That means anything in the universe will be trigunatmakam. If manas is trigunatmakam, anything received by your manas or mind will be interpreted in three affects. So those which are perceived also will be having those three affects, the stimulators of those three affects. So anything you perceive will be having the same constitution as your mind. That is why the whole universe itself is perceived to be or conceived to be having three factors. Another thing is, affect has a threshold. Already you have happiness in you. And when a happiness from outside an object is there, the happiness from the object is transmitted and received by you. When it reaches a threshold, it will be, when it comes above the threshold, happiness will be felt by you. Otherwise also happiness is there. Happiness is there already. But when the external object adds the happiness and it comes above the threshold, that will be expressed. Likewise, there is anger in you, hatred is there, or aggressiveness is there. Up to one extent, and up to some extent, up to the threshold, it is not expressed. But whenever it goes above the threshold, that aggressiveness will be, or hatred will be, or anger will be expressed. For this threshold, a stimulus by continuous low stimulation on a strong short stimulation exert irritation on the subject. As the irritation increases and passes the threshold level, excitation results. A stimulus, there can be a stimulus which is continuously exerting low stimulation. Once accumulated stimulation will be exceeding the threshold, it will be. That is why continuous low stimulation can cause a resultant anger or resultant irritation. Small thing happens daily. On the fifth day, it will be anger, because it adds to the previous one, it accumulates, and finally it goes beyond the threshold and the anger will be. Sometimes we say, last time he was not anger, this time he is anger, because all the day he is exposed to that angry factor or arrogance factor, but on the fifth day only it becomes above the threshold level, fifth day he will be anger. Likewise, happiness and confusion also. So there is a threshold factor, a stimulus by continuous low stimulation or a strong short stimulation. Sometimes what happens is even a single event will create anger, because that stimulus is stronger enough to produce anger. Okay. As the irritation increases and passes the threshold level, excitation results. So as a recap, we are capable of only three major affects. The perceptible universe or objects is capable of stimulating us only in three ways. The receptor affect and transmitter of the affect should have the same principle in them. Only then reception and excitation or provocation could happen. This is the basic rule.